Good morning. Let's all stand. We'll begin our morning worship service by singing Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Let's stand and worship the Lord this morning. Here we go.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Shall see in His beauty the King in whose law I delight, who lovingly guardeth my footsteps and giveth me songs in the night.
Oh, redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb,
redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am.
Let's make all those around us feel welcome at Temple Baptist by greeting them this morning. Oh, good. Never hurts. I can move on. All right, let's rescue the perishing this morning.
And rescue the perishing and care for the dying. Snatch them in pity from sin and the Jesus the mighty to save. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. And though they are slighting Him, still He is waiting, waiting the penitent child to receive. Plead with them earnestly and plead with them gently. He will forgive if they only believe. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. And rescue the perishing, duty demands it. Strength for thy labor the Lord will provide. And back to the narrow way, patiently win them. Tell the poor wanderer a Savior has died. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save.
Good morning, church. Oh, this is the day the Lord hath made. And look at the host of folks here today. God bless you. Some of you, it looks like you're visitors. We're going to recognize you later on. And thank you for looking online and watching our service online. We thank you for that. And we hope you receive a blessing here today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you for your many mercies this week. Oh, Lord, thank you. Thank you for your grace this week, Father. Thank you for the trials that we've had this week to make us more dependent upon you. And so, Father, we pray that you would bless our service today. And we're so glad to have the island pastor, Brother Randy Crow, and his dear wife, Paula, here with us today. And look forward to what you have for us through him today. We look forward to that. So, God, bless our service as only you can. May the Holy Spirit work in hearts of men and women, boys and girls. We pray in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. You may be seated. Oh, wow. I love the ministry. And every one of us, as Brother Mike Flynn told us this morning, we're all involved in the ministry. Mike brought a great message, a lesson this morning in our fellowship Sunday school class talking about teamwork. And how many of you, by just raising your hand, somewhere, someplace, even if a prayer warrior, how many of you are volunteering in the ministry and praying for the ministry of this church? Let me see your hand. Raise your hand right there. God bless you. That's nearly every hand that's gone up. It's certainly every member's hand that's gone up. And we thank God for this. One of the ministers we have here is our school and 200-plus students. And we're just... Brother Mark teaches the voice and teaches guitar and ukulele and the recorder, all the things, and piano and all. It's wonderful. Well, Mark is not a surfer dude. He's not. But he goes and takes his group. There's a new group called Trust, and he took them. There he is. He took them to, can y'all see that right there? What was it? Ron Johns. And sang at Ron John's. Christian songs.
Yes, sir.
At Ron John's.
Yes,
people
sir.
Walking in and out. Were they throwing tomatoes at you?
Didn't throw anything.
No, didn't throw anything. They throw money at you.
Well, we wish. But.
Okay. Isn't that wonderful, though, to go to a secular venue? Everybody's heard of Ron John. If you travel up 75 or 95 coming into Florida, you see the Ron John signs and the surfboard. So, Mark, I think this is a little too small, but your first grandson, they got to get married first. But the first, oh, this is new. Look at this.
Wow. Oh, you can almost see it. There it is.
There you go. All right. I'm going to have fun with this. All right. This is what I've always wanted this, and Trent Mansfield has been able to do this so that when we have other people here and they're playing or singing or preaching, we can do that, and you can see things better. So, yeah, Ron John, can you focus on that? We're going to have some fun here, right? That's Rock John right there. How close can you get? That's better. Okay, go. That's great. And so isn't it great to be able to reach out into our community in Brevard and to go and to share the gospel, share Christ in so many ways. And we do that so many ways through visitation, through all of our ministries here. It's a great thing. One thing that's coming up, what's the next big thing coming up church-wise? We had Christmas, but now what is it? Easter's coming up. And so my wife has prepared an announcement I need to make. We're preparing baskets. We no longer do Easter egg hunts. We haven't done that for about 3 years now. What we do is for the children that come on Sunday, Easter Sunday, when they leave, not before, but when they leave, they'll get a basket. And it's going to have some candy. Let me read the announcement. Gifts and candy to give to the children. So if you would, donate, if anybody wants to do that, up to $10, but $10 will pay for the basket and all the goodies inside of it. So what we like to do is we can give every child a basket. They don't have to go out here and cry and sweat and get their Sunday patent shoes all dirtied up, and parents loving it, you know. So they leave here with a basket full of goodies and tracts, and just a reminder of who Christ is. It's not the Easter Bunny. It's Jesus. It's about the cross, and they'll have the baskets there. So if you would remember that, if you'd like to do that today or next Sunday, Palm Sunday. Next Sunday, be prepared to do that. And just put it in the envelope and just mark it for Easter. Just mark Easter basket, okay, on that. That'll be great. And then people need to dress in biblical costumes to be part of the crowd scene in the program on Easter Sunday morning. You're going to hear a wonderful song today, Via Della Rosa. And so as Jesus is carrying the cross down the Via Della Rosa, we have a crowd scene. And you can't be wearing your 2024 clothes. You got to be. So we have costumes for you. So please sign up at the front desk if you're in the play or in the crowd, the scene, crowd scene. Then put your name down on a sign-up sheet in the lobby, and you will be contacted. And then we have one rehearsal that you will be asked to come to, and you will be given a costume at that rehearsal. And that rehearsal is on Friday, March the 29th at 6 p.m. I'm sorry?
It's Good Friday.
That's Good Friday. So Friday, March 29th, 6 p.m. Is that for everybody? Is that your dress rehearsal?
Yes, sir.
Dress rehearsal, and then the people who have volunteered to be in the crowd will learn where they go.
Okay. All right. Mm-hmm. Okay. So... for you that are in the crowd, that's the only Sunday you got to be here for, okay? Or the only day.
Right.
Friday, March 29th, Good Friday, 6 o'clock at night. All right, very good. Other announcements to make is school is out. This is spring break for the kids, and so they're out this week. The office, church office will be in and out this week. I'm doing something with our senior class this week. Looking forward to that in the middle of the week. But Wednesday night services will be going on, Sunday Bible study next Sunday morning at 10 o'clock. Just take note of that. Worship team practice this Tuesday, March the 5th. Mm-hmm. This Tuesday, none today, right?
None today.
Nothing today, but this coming Tuesday, March 5th, 6 p.m. right here in the auditorium. Sorry for all the announcements, but that's that time of year, so we got to get all that in. All right, I believe that's going to be. Thank you for your prayers. Becky and I were gone. We went up to the Cove. How many of you been to the Cove? Billy Graham's The Cove. Anybody been? Let me highly recommend that. If you can get away and go to, they do concerts, but then they had a retreat for us pastors and our wives. And there were 120 couples there. So 240 people up in Asheville, North Carolina. So we were there for 3 days and then saw Becky's mother in Knoxville and then saw, how many of y'all remember John and Linda Brand? Saw the Brands. They said to say hello, and we appreciate that. If you're visiting with us for the very first time, you're our honored guest. We're so glad you chose Temple Baptist Church to be your place of worship today. Would you just hold your hand up? You're here for the first time, never been here before. We're going to give you a card. Won't call you out by name because we don't know your name just yet. Anybody at all? All right. God bless you, Brother Mark.
All right, we're going to stand and worship about the beautiful name of Jesus. Let's stand and we'll sing and worship his name, beautiful name of Jesus.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed. Name it is the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is, and nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus. You brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. And what could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is, the name. Christ my King. What a powerful name it is, and nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
What a privilege, what a blessing. Brother Mike's going to come and pray for the offering this morning, for God to bless it. And oh, man, a child of the King. Did you get that one? A child of the King. Join heirs with Jesus Christ. You know, a lot of times we take our salvation for granted. You know that? We do. Oh, we're saved, going to heaven. But, man, when you get in the Word, start contemplating all that we have in Christ Jesus, it is phenomenal. It's a blessing. It's humbling is what it is. Brother Mike.
Man. We just studied about God created every single one in this room. He created you for a purpose. He created you to be a child of His. And you are. Let's go to Him and praise Him, worship Him. Gracious Heavenly Father, we love You. Thank You, Father, for creating us. Thank You, Father, for blessing us and pouring Your love out on us, for calling us to be Your messenger to this world. Father, I just pray that today in this service, Father, that we would worship You, that we would honor You, that we would dedicate our lives to You. Father, I pray now as we receive this offering, I pray, Lord, that you would bless it, that you would multiply it, that it might be used to just to spread the gospel throughout Brevard County, throughout Florida, throughout the world. Father, I just pray that all that give would give with joy, that they would give of all that you've blessed them with. And Father, that you would bless them and the gift. I pray in Jesus' name.
The crowd pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating. There were stripes upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his the scorn of those who cried out for his death. Down the Via Dolorosa, caught the way of suffering. Like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ the King. But he chose to walk that road out of his love for you. Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary. Por la Via Dolorosa, tres de día en Jerusalén, los soldados le abren paso a Jesús. La gente se acercaba para ver aquí.
Thank you, Naomi. Thank you, Mark. Yeah, I tell you, that doesn't bless you.
Your blessing's broke.
Your blessing's broke. There you go. All right. Before I introduce a man that needs no introduction at Temple Baptist Church, the statistics today are 80% of unchurched people that are invited to come to an Easter service will come.
That's right.
The sad thing is only 20% of the church is asking non-church people to come on Easter Sunday. So I'm saying don't be part of the 20%. Go to your neighbors, walk over to the and just say, we're having a wonderful Easter program. We would love to have you and invite people to come to the service 2 weeks from today, the last Sunday of this month. Becky and I, as I said, we went away for some spiritual renewal and refreshment for pastors and their wives, and certainly we got just that. And that would not be possible if I didn't have somebody like Randy Crow to call and to say, you say, well, Pastor, you're here. Why do you have him here? I learned this a long time ago, and only you that deal with people will understand this and speak a lot. It's great to be able to be unplugged and not think about a sermon for next Sunday. So when we left here Sunday, last Sunday after church, we left here about 2 o'clock and started our trek up to North Carolina. I wasn't having to, I could be totally unplugged to receive what Christ had for Becky and I, the Holy Spirit, to work in our hearts. And that's only possible if I have somebody to fill in. Brother Mike Flynn did a wonderful job teaching the encouragers class, adult class over here this morning, so I didn't have to worry about a Sunday Bible study. I love to speak and I love to preach. It's not that, but I needed to be unplugged. Yeah. And because of Mike and because of our preacher, who again needs no introduction, Mike Crow, his lovely wife Paula's with him today, and we look forward to fellowshipping afterwards. He and I and our wives and some others. But I can call him. He lives just north of here in the New Smyrna area, and he retired. But they call him the island pastor because for many years he pastored a church and built a church there in the Bahamas and is continuing working in the Bahamas and rebuilding after Dorian, the huge hurricane that hit there many years ago. And so please give a temple welcome to my dear friend and ours, Brother Randy Crow.
Amen. Thank you, Mike. Well, glory. Hey, thank you for the song, Villa Della Rosa.
We had the privilege to be in Israel some years ago, before the world went gazunk, and we got to go there. And in Israel, there is the Villa Della Rosa now. It is way down underground because through the years they built on top of Jerusalem everywhere. And you had to go down into the bottom in the area. And Paula and I got to kneel and to pray on that Villa Della Rosa. And they are absolutely convinced that is the road that Jesus walked down with his cross. And it was a moving, moving experience. And to hear that song, and you did such a wonderful job. You really did. Thank you so much. And then don't y'all ever take Mark for granted. I'm just telling you. It's great to have a song like that, but to have a pianist like that. Y'all did pretty good.
Amen.
Well, great. My wife Paula is here. We've been together 52 years this year. And we have a friend of ours, Deb Hefner. You'll want to meet her. She lost her husband 2 years ago, but her and her husband came down every year and spent 2 to 3 months with us in doing ministry to the Out Islands, where we would do pastor's encouragement conferences and all kind of stuff. Her husband sang and blew a horn, a trumpet, and did gospel magic. And we went all over the Bahamas together doing that, and it's good to have Deb down, and she's spending a week or so with us, so God is good. Let me give you just a quick update. We were in West Palm Beach Friday night. I serve as chairman of the board of Missionary Flights International, and as y'all know, Haiti's in a mess, am I right? It is unreal what's going on in Haiti, and we normally would fly there 2 times a week. We have not been able to fly there for the last 3 weeks. The airspace is closed, and there's nothing we can do about that. And so we're waiting for it to open. We have a list of people that are waiting to be evacuated, and we'll send in the airplanes. We have 2 DC-3s, and we just have just about finished paying for a 3rd DC-3. And we're going to have 3 of those things. At the banquet the other night, we found out now a DC-3 was built in 1947, 44, 45. They're old airplanes. But when we get through with them, they look like brand new. And we got one coming that is like brand new. You wouldn't know it didn't just come off the showroom floor. And they cost $6 million. Do y'all hear that figure? $6 million. That's a lot of dollars. But we're down, as of the banquet the other night, we were down to just $96,000 that we owe on that airplane. And we're grateful that God has brought all that in. And the banquet down in West Palm on Friday night might have paid the balance. We won't know that until Monday when they count everything, but it might be all done. And then it'll get painted, and then it'll be coming in to MFI. And we'll have 3 airplanes that are flying down from the DR, Dominican Republic, Haiti, and the Bahamas. Had an airplane yesterday in the Bahamas that was carrying in supplies and stuff that they need down there. So we're grateful. Lolly and Reg are here. Dear friends, my goodness, we've ate with them and laughed with them, swam with them, been out on their boat, all kind of stuff. Paula was trying to tell our missionary wife that's with us, says now that Lolly, she can dive better than most men. Now, there was a day when Dolly would go down, she could go down and get all those crawfish and all those grouper and all that stuff. And we had a great time with them. Now, we'll be on their island for the month of May. If y'all are home, we'll get to see you a bunch. But we'll be down in the Spanish Wells the month of May, and we'll have a great, great time down there. Hey, did you bring your Bible? Hold it up, because that makes the devil mad. Hold it up. That just makes him mad. Now, you can hold your phone up if you're going to use your phone. You can do that. As long as you're going to be on the Bible app, don't be on the Facebook app. Amen. Don't get on that Twitter thing or the Instagram. Get on your Bible app. But turn to John chapter 5. Would you do it? I want to share something with you this morning. It is an unusual story. You don't hear a lot of people preach on this particular story, but I hope I can glean a couple of things out of it that will help you this morning. If you found John chapter 5, I want you to say amen. Amen. All right, look at verse number 1 and watch what it says. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now, this is about the first or second year in Jesus' public ministry. He's just beginning to do the miracles and to greet the people, and they're beginning to figure out who he really is. Look at verse number 2. So there's a feast there. Look, and he's going up to Jerusalem. Now look at verse number 2. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep gate a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having 5 porches. That's important. Remember those words. 5 porches. And then look in verse 3. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folks, blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the waters. For an angel went down at certain seasons, not all the time, at certain times, certain seasons, into the pool and troubled the waters. And whosoever then first, after the troubling of the water, stepped in was made well, and whatever disease they had. Now, that's a pretty simple thing. They're all gathered around this porch, this area. It's by the sheep gate. And the sheep gates where they'd bring them in for the sacrifice for the Passover. And it's the gate that is showing that, you know, Jesus is going to be the ultimate lamb that's going to be sacrificed. You're going to celebrate next Sunday, Palm Sunday, as he enters into Jerusalem. And then on Easter, we're going to celebrate his resurrection out of Israel. All the things that God has done has just been amazing, and it all fits. But it says it's near the sheep gate. Look what happens in verse number 5. It says, and a certain man was there who had an infirmity. That just means a weakness. That's what that is. It's just a weakness that he's got. And look what it says, that he has an infirmity 38 years. How long, church? 38 years. That's a long time. Say, yeah, it is.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, that's a long time. Look what happens in verse number 6. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had been this now a long time, he said unto him, wilt thou be made well or whole? Do you want to get whole? The impotent man answered and said, sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool, but while I am coming, another steppeth before me. Then look at verse number 8. Jesus saith unto him, rise, take up thy bed, and do what, church?
Walk.
Look at verse number 9. And immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked, and the same day was the Sabbath. You know, Jesus had a real problem of healing on the Sabbath, didn't he? He just kind of did that. Look what happens in verse number 10. The Jews therefore said unto him, that was cured, it is the Sabbath day. It is not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. He answered and said unto them, he that made me well the same day said, take up thy bed. So I took up thy bed and I walked. And that's pretty simple, isn't it? Look what it does in verse number 12. Then they ask him, what man is he who said unto thee, take up thy bed and walk? And he said that it was he, and he that was healed knew not who it was, for Jesus had moved away from the multitude being in that place. So he didn't even know it was Jesus. So now he's gone to the temple. Look what happens in verse number 14. Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple and said unto him, behold, thou art made well. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. And then verse number 15, the man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had made him whole. And therefore did the Jews persecute Jesus, sought to slay him because he had done these things on the Sabbath day. Now, y'all, that's how messed up religion can get. They're just so messed up. because Jesus had healed this man, and because it was on the Sabbath, that verse number 16 says that they begin to go after him and they wanted to get rid of Jesus because he's doing these things. Because religion can be a mess up. Now, when you get to the story and you begin to read it, you begin to see that Bethesda, that word Beth just means house, and Seda, that just means mercy. In other words, this was the house of mercy. The place of mercy ought to be the church. Would y'all say amen? Amen. That ought to be the church. But so many times the church becomes a place of judgment or a place of criticism. A place where if you don't fit into our mold or you don't do it and think like we are, and before you know it, it's not the place of mercy. But that's what this was now. It was a place in Jerusalem where they had this pool. Now, the historians, the Bible doesn't say this, but the historians of the era, they begin to say that this was as big as an Olympic-sized pool. It was a large area. As a matter of fact, it was so big, it had five porches. Remember that up there? We have five porches that are there. And that would be so they could all gather, the people that are invalids and the people that need healing. They would all just lay around those porches all day, getting out of the sun, waiting on the stirring of the water. And the water didn't stir just at any time. It only happened on certain occasions to where that water was there. Look what it says in verse number 3. Go back over to verse number 3. And these lay a great multitude. Now, how many is a multitude? I don't know. Is there 100 there? Is there 1,000 there? I would imagine for sure there's going to be several hundred that had gathered there because they knew that if that water was stirred by that angel, if they could get in that water first, they're going to be the ones that's going to get healed. And they would have just gathered there and gathered there. Look what happens in verse number 4. And the angel went down and troubled the waters, and whoever got in the troubled waters was made well or made whole. But now here's the neat, the strange thing. Jesus is now walking up. Watch this. Jesus is walking up, and look what he says in verse number 6. He says, when Jesus saw him, saw who? The man that's been with an ailment for 38 years, an infirmity, a weakness. He's been that way for 38 years. And when Jesus came up, Jesus asked a strange question. You would think, well, that's an unnecessary question, but Jesus would never do something unnecessary. Watch what he does in verse number 6. And Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had been thus now a long time. How long? 38 years. Look at the next part. He saith unto him, wilt thou be made, what's the word, church? Whole. In other words, do you want to be healed? Now, what a question. You would think the man would have jumped up and said, well, yeah, I want to be healed. Remember, he doesn't know who Jesus is. Remember, this is just a man saying, do you want to be whole? Do you want to be made well? And then, look what he does. It's amazing when you unfold this story that's there. Because we understand the angel comes and he stirs the water. They're all gathered there. They're all sitting around the steps. If that's the pool down there, they're all sitting around these steps all day long. I mean, they've gathered. Like kind gathers like kind. It's kind of like a homeless area where there's a homeless area. They gather. In the Bahamas, we have a lot of illegal Haitians that come over. And they will go on to somebody's land in the back. There's a lot of empty land, like in the middle of Florida. And they'll go out and they'll build these villages in there. And they'll have a Haitian village that's there. And before you know it, the government will come in and they'll kind of tear down those villages. But what happens is like people gather in like places. We just do that. When I pastored in St. Petersburg, Florida, we had a lot of folks from Michigan and a lot of folks from Indiana and Illinois. Now, I pastored over here at First Baptist New Smyrna Beach for 11 years, and I had a lot of folks over here that were different areas. There was a lot of them from Pennsylvania in different places like that, some from Indiana. What did they do? People that know somebody, they'll go back home and they'll tell everybody, well, you ought to go move down here because if you want to be a snowbird, here's the place to be because this is where we are. And they, in like kind, the same thing would have happened with this. Here's all these people, they've gathered on this porch and they're sitting there and Jesus walks up. They don't know it's Jesus. Jesus walks up and he asks a simple question. Do you want to be made whole? Do you want to get healed? And you would have thought the man would have said yes. But he acted like most of us. Look what he does in verse number 6. Because the first thing he does is he makes an excuse. Look what he says. The impotent man answered and said, sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me in the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth before me. Here's what happens. See, when we look, and we think, I want to be delivered. And Jesus says, well, you want to get healed from that? And then here he does. He says, well, I'd like to be healed, but it's not my fault. It's not my fault. Because if I could get in there when it first stirred the water, I'd have got healed. And he didn't realize he's talking to Jesus. But the first thing he does is he gives an excuse, just like most of us do. When Jesus is dealing with us and all, I mean, you know, somebody will come in and they'll say, well, I know God can heal a marriage, but he can't do mine. You ever heard that? Well, I know God heals, but yeah, but it won't be for me. I've heard this one. I know Pastor Tom has. Well, I know tithing works. It just won't work for me. Hello? See, we come up with excuses. When Jesus is there to deliver us, and he's there to let us go and to bring us about. I mean, the man is sitting there waiting to get in. 38 years he's been waiting, and there's the water, and he's sitting here. I thought, well, you could just roll off into the water, couldn't you? Couldn't you got up there, get close, and you think, well, when it troubles? But for 38 years, he got comfortable where he was. Because sometimes we get comfortable where we are. Say, oh, me, church. Yeah, we get comfortable where we are. And maybe it doesn't fit the way we think it should happen because it's done different. And we think, well, my goodness, it's not happening the way I think it should happen. But see, God is so fresh that he does things fresh. And he's looking at that impotent man that with a weakness and probably paralyzed, I'm not sure, doesn't really, really, really say. But here all of a sudden, Jesus is just saying, do you want to be made well? Do you want to be made whole? Do you really want to stay where you are? And you know what? I think some people, Pastor Tom's done it like I have. I think some people want to be miserable. They enjoy being miserable. I mean, I had them in my church. Tom probably doesn't have them here. They just want to be miserable. I don't want to forgive them. I like carrying a grudge. I don't want to get over that. You don't know what he did to me or she did to me. You don't understand what's in the back. You just don't know my situation. Listen, we keep making excuses and God's saying, hey, I'm here to deliver you. I'm here to deliver you. That's what he's here for. Because that's what he does now. Not only did he make an excuse, because that's what we do. But see, you say, well, how did he get out of it? He had to put forth an effort. He had to do something. Look what happens in verse number 8. Watch this. Jesus saith unto him, arise, take up thy bed, and do what, church? Do what? Walk. He walked 38 years. Jesus didn't say, be healed. He didn't do that, did he? He just looked at him and he says, do you want to be made whole? Well, I want to be made whole, but every time I get ready to go in the water, somebody's already gone in there before me. So I bless my heart. I'm just poor, pitiful little old me. And Jesus says, take up your bed and walk. You got to put an effort in it. You can't stay in the area of the cesspool and expect to come out of it. You just can't. It doesn't happen. You have to put an effort into it. And only God can bring that effort about. We want to help everybody. A pastor does. I'm so grateful. One, thank you, church, for letting your pastor and wife go off for a week and get renewed. Paula and I did that multiple times. Our church, just for information, when I pastored in New Smyrna Beach, we'd been there 5 years, and the church sent us on a cruise. So I'll put a plug in. Y'all send them on a cruise. Amen. You say, I ain't ever been on one. Pastor ought not. No, y'all take care of your pastor. Amen. I'll take care of it. Grateful that y'all let him go off this week. I really am. I mean, that'll give him renewed strength, and it'll encourage them. Their marriage is not in trouble, but it'll just strengthen it without a doubt. Because, see, we pastors, we think we can fix everything. And, see, we have all these folks coming at us. He does. I did. You have all these folks coming at you and all these needs. I'll never forget, I grew up in Atlanta, and my first church was in Atlanta area, Atlanta, Georgia. And when I was pastoring that church and I was the new guy and I barely got through Bible college and I was doing seminary and I just got a church of about 200 and it was a messed up church, which is usually what you get as your first church. It was messed up. It split and the guy that had been there went a half mile up the road and started another church. That's how bad it was. And I'm pastoring this little church and I don't know what to do. I'm trying to heal everybody. I'm trying to get everybody together, and I'm trying to meet all the needs that I can meet. And I was doing all I could. I was working all kind of hours. I was busy. I was doing what I thought pastors were supposed to do, and that is take care of everybody. But you know what? You can't do that. You can't. God gave me a wake-up call. I was in the office, and the secretary said, your next appointment's here. And I said, okay, who is it? She says, well, she's just coming over. It was my wife, Paula, had booked an appointment through my secretary to meet with me because I was so busy that she never had time to get with me. And I was only 27 years old, 28 years old. And God used Paula to wake me up. So she walked in the door, and I thought, what are you doing here? She said, I just booked an appointment. I want to spend some time with you. I said, okay, you made your point. She said, oh, no, big boy. I still got 55 minutes. And we sat in the office and we talked and we prayed and I apologized. Because, see, we think we got to solve everything. You know, there's a lot of problems around people have. And you bombard the pastor and it's okay. He doesn't mind that. But remember, he can't fix everything. Say amen. Amen. Can't do it. You got to put some effort in. He could tell you what to do and be right. If you don't put any effort in, it ain't going to change. You got to put some effort in. What'd that guy do? He got up, got his bed, started walking. He put effort into it. And then watch the last thing. You got to see this. Because look at verse number 9. And immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked. And the same day was a Sabbath. He had an experience. God met him. And then you know the rest of the story. I won't spend time on it. You know the rest of the story. You know, all of a sudden, here comes the religious leaders, and they said, what are you doing carrying your bed on the Sabbath? It wasn't against the law to carry your bed on the Sabbath. It was against the law to work and earn living on the Sabbath. But the church had taken it to such extremes that you couldn't do anything on the Sabbath. And walking with your bed would be considered work, and that wasn't the law. That's not what the law said. But they made it so restrictive so they could be in charge and they could keep you under their thumb and they could get to where they could control you. Does it sound like governments? Hello? Yeah. Where they can control you. That's what the religious system was trying to do. Listen, we were in Israel. And this is the truth. We're in Israel. And we're staying in a hotel. And it's like a 15, 18-story hotel. And we're staying there. And they have two elevators on the Sabbath. One elevator stops on the even floors. The other elevator stops on the odd floors. And you don't have a button. They cover the buttons to push for it to come back down. They've got it up there on this little thing. And you can see that it's on floor number 18, but it's coming down. So you know it's on the way. So when you get on the elevator, you don't push a button because that would be work. Is that silly? But that is happening yesterday in Israel. It's still there because that would be considered work. But see, we mess it all up, and Jesus is just saying, hey, I just came here. I want to set you free, and I want to heal you, but you got to put some effort into it. The lame, he picked up his bed, walked. Then when Jesus found him in the temple, Jesus said, hey, glad you're here. But then the religious leaders figured out it was Jesus, and then they decided they want to kill him. Now, here's the message. What is your weakness that you have that you would like for God to touch? What's your weakness? You say, well, I can't think of one. Ask your wife. She'll give you a list. What's your weakness? What is it that's your infirmity? You know, Paul said, the thorn in the flesh, he said, I'd glory in my infirmities because when I'm weak, then I am what, church? Strong. What's your infirmity? What's your weakness? What would you like for God to set you free of? But see, here's the problem. There's a lot of people don't want to be set free. They act like they pray about it. But then they go right back to doing what they've always done because they didn't put any effort of getting up and walking away from where they were. One of the neat things about that story, here's this guy, 38 years, he knew nothing but to go to the pool and to sit there all day long waiting on the water. 38 years. When he walked off with his bed, he didn't have to come back there anymore. Say amen. See, that's your difference. But see, there's so many that just says, no, I want to stay in where I'm at. I just want to stay in the hog pen. I just want to. And God's saying, hey, what do you want to get delivered from? What do you want to be set free from? That's what that is all about. It's about being set free. What do you want God to deliver you from? All we got to do, yeah, we got to pray, we ask. But then we have to get up and put some effort and go do what we got to do. I don't know if y'all have seen Alistair Biggs before. He's a guy from Scotland, just a great preacher, Alistair Biggs. And he gives this wonderful story, just a great illustration. He's just preaching and he says, you know what? I can't wait to meet that guy that was on the cross beside Christ. I can't wait to meet him because he's on the cross. He's a thief. He's guilty. He deserves what he's going to get. But he's hanging on that cross, and here's Jesus. And then Jesus looks over at him when he asks for his forgiveness. Jesus looks and says, today you'll be with me in where? That's what Jesus did, didn't he? He just said, hey, you know, he didn't scold him. He didn't degrade him. The man repented, and Jesus just said, today you'll be with me in paradise. Now, can you imagine? When that guy got up there to the throne, what in the world he's going to tell him? because, you know, here comes the angel, and angel comes down and says, sir, why are you here? He said, I don't know. He said, well, how'd you get here? I don't know. Well, do you understand the doctrine of theology? Never heard of it. Well, let's just go. What about the doctrine of adoption? Do you understand? I don't know what you're talking about. And I love it because Alistair Biggs says the angel will look, go get the supervisor and come back and says, you know, let me ask you, you know, what do you know? What Sunday school class did you go to? I didn't go to one. And here's this thief coming into heaven, and he says, on what grounds are you here? And here's what's so good. Listen, don't miss this. What grounds are you here? He says, the man on the middle cross said I could come. Isn't that it, church? See, the man, well, who healed you? Well, it was Jesus. Well, why are you carrying your bed? Because he said, the man that, I love that story. Why are you carrying your bed on the Sabbath? The guy that made me whole said, pick up your bed. I obeyed him. It's effort. You're never going to change without God's intervention, and then you got to obey and let God do it. You can't just sit back and say, well, I prayed about it. Some of you have been praying about something for a long time. It's time to quit praying. Start doing. Making it happen. Only you can do that. You see, here's this guy, 38 years, sitting on steps like this, just there's the water, waiting on it to churn. He couldn't get there. And then Jesus heals him. And then let me close with this. You ready for this? Jesus didn't heal everybody at that pool. Why did that one guy get healed? Why did Jesus walk around all these others? Because, see, here's what I think. This is for me and Pastor Tom. You see, there's always people that have needs around you. But we have to be so sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Because, see, that's Jesus now. Jesus has came, and he's obeying the will of the what? Father. Later on in that same chapter, it says that Jesus says, I'll say what God, my Father says. I'll do what my Father says. Jesus had to walk through all those others because God had appointed him that one right there. And Jesus was so sensitive. He knew who that was and he was to minister to. And when he ministered, that individual got up and carried his bed. But everybody else didn't get healed. Y'all ever been to the place to where you feel like you got stepped over and somebody else got healed or somebody else got the blessing? See, we got to follow the Holy Spirit. I'll pray for your pastor that he'll have such a sensitive heart in his wife that whatever's going on. Listen, I think Satan sends people into our lives that distracts us. Because they've always got a problem, an issue. There's always something, and there's nothing wrong. Most of them are real, and they're real issues. But hear me. You've got to be sensitive to say, yeah, but I got to go minister to this one right over here because here's what God's called me. This one right here. Because we can't solve all of it. All we can do is be obedient to what God's called us to do. And see, when you get to the place to where you say, Lord, I want you to deliver me. You say, well, God can't do that. Yeah, he can. You're the only one that's in charge of your destiny. Did y'all hear me? You're the only one. Nobody else can keep me from loving God but me. I can love God. If I'm in prison, I can still love Jesus. Say amen. I don't care. Wherever we are. I'll never leave you nor wherever you are, I'll be there. That's what he says. But see, a lot of us just want to say, hey, I just want to stay here. I want to sit on the steps and make excuses of why I can't get healed. I want to make excuses of why I can't get delivered. Church, listen. God wants to deliver us if we'll just obey Him. Hey, stand up. Would y'all do that? Father, we love You this morning. Father, thank You for Pastor Tom and Becky and, Lord, their heart. Lord, thank You for Mark and his wife and their heart for this ministry and these people. And, Lord, they want to fix everything. They do. They're in ministry, Lord. That's what we're kind of embedded into, that we want to take care of all of it, Lord. But, Father, You didn't call us to meet everybody's needs. You said that You would meet the needs. Lord, we just have to be available. That's what You said. Lord, can't solve the world's problems. Lord, if I could, I'd fix a political disarray in America right now, Lord. But God, I can't do that. But Lord, I can pray. I can seek Your face. And Lord, I can pray that You will have Your guidance and Your strength. Lord, there's some folks here today that, Lord, You're looking at them and saying, hey, do you want to be made whole? And Lord, there's some here that they're probably saying, you know what? No, I don't. Because my affliction brings me attention. If I got rid of the affliction, I wouldn't get all the attention. But Lord, You want to set us free. Lord, teach us how to do that. Only You can do that. So, Father, I ask You this morning, in this invitation time, You do Your work. I can't do it. Don't have a clue of how to give it. But, Lord, You can. So, Father, I pray. There's somebody here that just says, you know what? I've been saying I wanted to get healed, but I just never did because I really didn't want to. Lord, break us. Make us available so that we'll serve You. Lord, what's our weakness? Set us free. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Pastor Tom.
Come to Jesus. Are you willing to do that? Are you willing to wake up every morning and say, Jesus, I want to come to You. I want to draw close to You so that You'll draw close to me. Big difference when you and the Lord are close together. You're walking with the Lord and in tune with His heart. That's a big difference, isn't it? Sure is. Brother, I've been on that elevator over in Jerusalem and seen you don't touch the buttons. And that's an experience. That's how far religion has went. It's not about religion. How ridiculous is that? That's work. And religion, it's about a what?
Relationship.
With who? Jesus. Do you know Jesus? Do you know for sure you're going to heaven when you die? Boy, don't leave here. I pray God gives you no peace and no rest until you nail that down. Because to be an effective Christian for the Lord, you better know you're saved. Pastor, I feel guilty. Sometimes I doubt myself. That happens. Okay, that happens. But you can look at this is the authority of the word. I'm not preaching another message, but look at the authority of the word of God. Okay? For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Not maybe, not hope so. Shall be saved. I challenge you, listen to this, and we'll be closed. If you're dealing with, you're doubting your salvation, and I may bring a message to that, but go to our website, you have it in your bulletin, templebc.net, and then go to Done, all right? And Gary Schmidt has written a book called Done. Religion is do. Do this, do that, do this, do that. Jesus said on the cross, it is finished, it's done. So look up that book. It's a short read, it's a video. If you want to listen to it, you can put it in your ears and do your walk or work around the house, whatever, and listen to it. I challenge you to listen to that book. Father, thank you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you for this day. It's been a good day. And Father, we pray that you'll dismiss us now with your blessings. And again, Father, we pray that you'll give those that are here, maybe one or two that are here, that they're not sure they're going to heaven. They're searching. Father, may you give them no peace, no rest, until they come to themselves and they say, I need to know. And you have not because you ask not, the Bible says. And so, Father, we would love to show them not our way, but your way. Jesus said it best, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. And Father, that's not narrow, that's truth. So bless us, dismiss us with your blessings, we pray. Thank you for Brother Crow and his wife and guests being with us today. And Father, may we go out this week as we leave this auditorium and read that sign back there that we're now entering into the mission field. Let us take that to heart and let us go and share Christ with those around us. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. 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 God bless you.